About optimal prediction measures. Jacqueline, please.
Okay, thanks, and thank you very much for the remarks of this very nice workshop and mini courses on interpolation and sampling. And I have decided to present, it's a really small note that I did together with Len Boss and Norm Levenberg. And it's a curiosity that ties two different problems which are related to sampling in this case. So sampling for me is going to be to recover the value of a function from some samples. And I will present which is the precise statement here. Okay, so the history here is of optimal prediction. This is a subject that comes from statistics. And here, what we want to do is we want to predict the value of a polynomial, and we only know the values of the polynomial at certain points in a set K. And maybe the value of the polynomials, I don't know it exactly, but there is some error in the measurement, and I want to recover the value of the polynomial at a point which is outside K. Okay, so K is a set of points here. In this set of points, I can, sorry, I have here some set K, and here I have some points where I measure, and I want to evaluate the polynomial in a point outside K. The point here is I have some finite amount of points to choose in K, and I want to choose them wisely in order to recover the value here with as small error as possible. And all the origins of this theory goes back almost 100 years ago, at least. It's by of optimal this optimal sampling. It's it goes back to Gustav Helwig, and I want to present the history of this. Gustav Helwig was a Finnish mathematician. He started to work in classical function theory. He did his PhD thesis with Ralph Nevanlinna. And when he finished in the 30s, in 34 or so, well, life was going very nicely for him. He was going to be a professor, I think. And but the point is that some tragedy happened, and his fiancée, she died of tuberculosis, I think it was. It was a very serious disease at that time, and he was utterly depressed. And when then his, well, what they were, the parents of his fiancée decided that it would be good for him to go abroad to forget about the death of her death. And they had contacts at the Academy of Sciences, and they enrolled him in an expedition to Greenland. And it was well, they had to take measurements in Greenland. It was a scientific expedition, a topographic expedition. And there, while he was in Greenland, he recounts that, well, the weather in Toronto, I don't know how it is, but in Greenland, it's rather tough. And that he was struck by some storms, and he was, these are some photos, by the way, by Gustav Helwig at Greenland, taking measurements. And he was stuck at his tent for many days. And there, at some point, he devised the, he claims that he devised the notion of optimal prediction while being there, because they had to go out to take measurements, and he wanted to go out as few times as possible, right? And to take them, to take some measurements in the best possible places, so he wouldn't have to go outside. So that's the origin of this field. And it's well, he eventually became what's one of the fathers of statistics in Finland. So I give now the precise and rigorous mathematic formulation of the problem. So We are, okay, I will place myself in CN, but of course the theory can be done in RN. So we have in CD, sorry, we have D variables, and N is going to be the degree of the polynomial. So we have P is going to be a polynomial of degree N variables. And I just pick an arbitrary basis, P1, P capital N, which is about N to the D components. So I take a basis of the polynomials, and I take an arbitrary polynomial, it's a linear combination of such. And now I have so a K is a given, and it's the place where I'm allowed to take measurements, where I'm allowed to take samples of the polynomial. So here P is my unknown polynomial, and I can pick M points, which is going to be M. I'm always going to assume that it's bigger than the dimension of the space of polynomials. So I take measurements at these points, zeta j in k, and these zeta j are going to be at my disposal. So I can pick whatever I want to pick the points in the region. And the point is that when I measure the value of the polynomial at the point p of zeta j, I don't get the precise value, but I get rather the value yj, which is the true value plus some error term. And this error term is supposed to come from my measurement instrument or whatever. So they are going to, it's well calibrated. So it's going to normal distribution, centered at zero, and with sigma. Okay. And now I have a point. So this point zeta is given to me. This is some point outside the set K, and I want to estimate P of zeta from the values of my measurements yj. Of course, if zeta was a point in K, I would just take all my measurements at the point zeta, but zeta is outside of K. It's clear that the situation. So that's the situation. And then I want to evaluate P at zeta. Okay, let's see. How do I get P of zeta? Well, P is this linear combination. So the first thing that I need to do is I need to find out which are the linear, the coefficients in this basis. So I need to estimate these parameters, theta k. And if I have more measurements than the, a priori, n is bigger than the dimension of the space, I have more measurements, I just take the standard procedures to take the least squares estimate, and this is provided by its value, okay, where y are the measurements, and here vn is just the matrix, the van der Mond matrix, pi of zeta j. Okay? So here I have the first polynomial, the second polynomial, and here. So this matrix has many more rows than columns. I'm assuming that little m is bigger than capital M, which is maybe a bit contradictory. Okay, so this is the standard solution in squares. No surprises here. And now, if once I have found out what's the of theta k, the coefficients, the predicted value of the polynomial is just the linear combination of pk of zeta with these values. So this is really a random variable x, because the value of the coefficients theta is given. Sorry, that was given by here theta is affected by the randomness of y. Y is the measurements, right? So this is a random variable. It's actually x. X is a random variable, which is going to be a Gaussian random variable, because it's a linear combination of Gaussian random variables, and I can easily check out which is the variance. You unwind the definition of the theta k, and you reach that the variance of x is this quantity. This is the quantity that And this is the precision on which, so whenever I take some measurements at the given points, I get a random variable, which the expected value is the true variable, and the variance is this one, okay? Good. Now, let's analyze a bit the variance, because I want to make the variance. The point here is to try to pick the points, zeta 1, zeta 2, zeta m, in a certain way, in such a way that the variance is as small as possible. So let's look a bit closer this this function, the variance of this random variable. Now I take the following measure. So I take a Dirac delta at the points xk. Xk are the points where we are sampling the function. We're sampling the polynomial at the points xk, and we want to recover the function at the points. So I take the probability measure. Okay, so this is a probability measure supported in k, compact, where I'm allowed to sample the function. And now this vn, vn star, this is just the Gram matrix with respect of the polynomials with respect to the measure mu. And this is just the definition. You just take the vn, vn star, and this is just the product of these two matrices. Vn star, by the way, is the adjoint and you take this product of these two matrices is just exactly this by definition. So here I'm taking the Gram matrix of the polynomials with respect to the empirical measure mu. And I just rewriting now the variance in terms of the Gram matrix, of the inverse, to be precise, of the Gram matrix associated to this L2 with respect to this discrete measure at the given points. Is it okay? Good. So now I want to analyze the variance. I mean, of course, there are elements in the variance which I can readily observe that will decrease. I want the variance to be as small as possible. So that means that P of zeta is as precise as possible. So the variance is decreases when I increase the number of samples. That's not very surprising. It decreases when sigma is small. That's also not surprising. If my instrument of recording is precise, that's the error. But the only thing that really depends on the position on the points is this part. So I want to minimize this quantity, the quantity. Okay. Good. Now let's see. Now we see that a reproducing kernel, it's showing up. Well, we have take any measure mu. Now in the now I did it with the measure mu was the mu was the discrete measure at the given points. But now I take an arbitrary measure mu in k. And I look at the Gram matrix multiplied by capital P of zeta. This is just this boldface P is just a column vector with it's P1 of zeta P as capital P. So now, if you take this product, you will see this is the reproducing kernel of at the diagonal Kn of zeta zeta because associated to this measure mu. So here I'm taking mu. This means I'm taking you take L2 of mu, and you look at the polynomials of this with the scalar product given by L2 of mu, and this is a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, and you. Take the, or an orthonormal basis, then the reproducing kernel is by definition this quantity, this space. And of course, this exists always. And here is GN, it was like the Gramian matrix. This, you are like orthonormalizing the basis P1, PN to get together producing carbon. So this is just a standard computation. So at the end of the day, what we get is that the variance is given by this quantity, right? So here it's 1 over m sigma square, and here we've got k mu n, because the reproducing kernel depends on two things, the scalar product, which is L2 of mu, and the space of functions. Here I'm considering the space of polynomials. So really this is what I want to minimize. The other things don't depend on the position of the points. This depends on the position of the points. So what I want to do really is to minimize the reproducing kernel of the space of polynomials with respect to L2 of mu. And that's what I want to do. The point zeta, and I want to minimize it on the point zeta. So zeta is given, k is given, and mu is what I need to choose. And I want to minimize this in order to get the best sampling points to recover the value of p of zeta with. And here I recall that the reproducing Berman kernel of the polynomials here in L2, they satisfy also this. It's not just this expression, the sum of the modulus of k, q sub k zeta square, but it's also the solution of some extremal problem. This is the extremal problem that it solved. It maximizes the quotient, no? The point evaluation with respect to the L2 norm. Or if you want, it maximizes the point evaluation among the polynomials that have L2 norm 1, or minimizes the L2 norm among the polynomials that have value 1 at the point. Okay. So in our case, fixing a point mu, a measure mu, the polynomial that achieves this sup is a maximum because this is a finite dimensional space. This is called a prediction polynomial for the point zeta with respect to the measure mu. Okay. So far? Good. So the problem for us, we are led to the following problem, and that's what we want to solve. Is given a point, given well, k is given, a compact in Cn, in Cd, sorry, in d variables, and I have a point zeta outside of the compact k. And what I want to do is to minimize the, for all probability measures, the Berman kernel at the diagonal. So I want to find the probability measure that that's best. Of course, for the original problem, I wanted this measure to be like a linear combination of m. If I had m points, just a linear combination of m direct deltas. But if I know which is the best probability measure, then I can discretize this measure with m points, and this will be a good approximation to the best possible positions, right? So now I suppose that I have like, I'm studying the problem asymptotically. No? I suppose that I have many, many possible samples. I can take samples. Which is the distribution? How should distribute these samples in the set K to get the best precision at the point zeta? So, and this is the problem of optimal design. And it's equivalent to finding, given zeta, to find the measure mu such that the Berman kernel associated to L2 of mu, to the scalar product given by this measure, is minimal at the point at the diagonal at this point. Okay. So that's the problem of optimal design. Well, to be honest, in statistics, there has been studied several different problems which are called optimal designs. This is one of the problems that the approach. But I want to present some other problems that have also been considered. There are other possible notions of optimal design, and there are many, many of them if you just look at the five, but these are the two most well known. One is it called the G-optimal design, and the G-optimal design is that say now that you want to minimize among all possible measures the one that such a way that the variance in all points in K, you don't know which point in K you want to evaluate the polynomial. You want it to do it for all points in K very well, simultaneously. Well, you take the worst possible case. For Schwarzschild scenarios, you take the reducing kernel at the worst point, so you take the maximum over all points in K, and then you try to make the worst case scenario as less bad as possible. Right, which is to make that find the points, the configuration of points that in the worst case scenario will not be so bad. So that's the G optimal design. And another possibility of design is you just tries to maximize the determinant of the design matrix, which was the design matrix is the Gramian associated to L2 of mu, the polynomials of degree n. And there is a theory in the late 70s, early 80s that says that these two notions, that was a theory by Kiefer and Wolfowitz, very well known in this area, which says that these two problems are equivalent. So any solution to this problem will give me a solution to this problem and vice versa. And that's the sort of result that we want to obtain for our original problem. So for this problem here, it will not be a complete description except in particular cases, but we will give a different problem which is equivalent to this one and which is also a classical one and have been studied. So we will try to connect two known problems. One problem is this optimal design. And first, before presenting the second problem, let me show you some examples of optimal designs. In some cases, we can actually compute what's the optimal distribution. By the way, the measure mu, which minimizes here the reproducing kernel at zeta, is usually called the prediction measure. And the polynomial that achieves the maximum, the reproducing kernel and the is called the prediction polynomial. So in our case, we want to identify which is the measure that optimizes this problem and which are the polynomials that achieve the supremum. Well, the one optimal here we have now I'm looking at K. K is going to be the unit disk and zeta some point outside of the disk. And in this case, one optimal prediction measure is, one can check, is the Poisson kernel measure associated to the point 1 over zeta bar. And this is the same prediction measure is optimal for all degrees, independent of the degree. So now here we are in one complex variable, so it's easier to check. In this case, you look at the minima look at the Poisson kernel measure, you compute the Gramian, and you compute the reproducing kernel, and it gives you that for this particular Poisson kernel, the L2 norm, the reproducing kernel at the diagonal, has the value zeta to the power 2n. And, it's just a matter of computation. For any other probability measure mu supported on K, if you look at the reproducing kernel, remember, now I'm going to check that this is really the best you can do. Take the Poisson kernel, you look at L2 of this harmonic measure, and you look at the polynomials of degree n, you orthonormalize it with respect to this measure, and you compute the reproducing kernel, and you get this. And now I'm going to check that really this is the smallest value that you can get for things which are supported here. Well, take any other measure mu which is supported on K. Then the reproducing kernel, we know that it satisfies this, is the supremum of all polynomials which which have value 1 and the L2 norm here, right? So now you do the you take as a polynomial p of omega, just take this polynomial, no, this take just one particular polynomial, and therefore the supremum will be bigger than this. So here I'm taking as a polynomial here, I'm testing this with omega, which is going to so this is a polynomial of degree n, which at the point zeta has value 1, clearly. And now you look at the L2 norm of this. Well, now if you look it on the boundary, this is just this. In the boundary, let's say it's going to be worse otherwise. It's this quantity. So this is always bigger than the reproducing, and this is actually the value that we achieved with the. So, in any case, what we get is that this is always bigger for any other measure supported on the disk. This is bigger than the. So, this is really optimal. But it is not the only optimal. It's not the only optimal. It's not the only prediction measure. And in this case, there are other discrete measures, for instance, provided by the zero quadrature formulas, that have the same n moments as mu zero. So there are other points in the boundaries, there are all points in the boundary of the disk, such that they have n, they are direct deltas with some weights, or there are n points there, so that they have the same moments as the measure mu zero, which was the Poisson kernel, and these measures, if they have the same moments, since everything depends on the Gramian, which is in the reproducing kernel depends on the Gramian, they will have the same Gramian. So they will have exactly the same. They will also have the same kernel of the layout. So this is not necessarily the uniqueness of the prediction measure. There may be several. Okay. Good. Now, this is one example, a very classical example. And another example, which was studied in detail by Hall and Levine, also in the 80s or 70s, is that when K is an interval, minus 1, 1. So, and now they prove that if you look at any other points, so now here, the set is minus 1, 1. But now you look at points zeta here in the real line, but outside K, and you want to sample points here. Now, what they observe is that, well, for any degree n, so because we have the best the support, the prediction measure is unique. There is no, and it's supported here in the zeros, so in these points, xk, which are the zeros of the polynomial. So you take angles k over n here, and you project the points here, the projections onto minus 1, 1 of the roots of unity, if you want. And these are the zeros of the classical Chebyshev polynomial, and in these points it is where it supported the optimal prediction measure, and they check that the Tn, the Chebyshev polynomial, it's going to be like the optimal prediction polynomial. So really, it is well known that Chebyshev polynomials is the solution of many extremal problems. This is one of them. So the for points here, at least outside in real points, this is one, which is the point where you should place. So if you want to evaluate a polynomial here, and you only can evaluate the polynomial in this interval, in the roots of these Chebyshev polynomials, this is the best place where you should take your samples. Okay, very good. Now I take a different a different problem, extremal problem. This was a problem which was it was studied by Erdos, and well, at least in one variable, and it's a classical problem in approximation theory and pluripotential theory. So you have a compact set now in several variables, and you have a point outside with it, and you look at the point, at the polynomial that has maximal growth at the point zeta with respect to k, yeah, relative to k. By this I mean, I take the polynomial where this quotient is maximal. Yeah? P sub k means the L infinity norm of p. Yeah? So I look, you want at the polynomials, among the polynomials which have value smaller or equal than 1 in k, the one that has maximal value at the point zeta. So everything is in terms of subnorms. And or if you want, I can alternatively, I can normalize p to be 1 at the external point, and I just want to find a polynomial that maximizes the growth here. Now, in this, for instance, the Chebyshev polynomials is also a solution to this problem if I take a point outside the real line, and this was proved, for instance, for k minus one. Well, this was proved by Chebyshev himself, I think. Okay? But Erdos proved that the Chebyshev polynomial is also extreme relative to minus one, not just for points in the for points in real points outside minus one one. So this is for points, but also for points which are outside here the disk. So when you have a point zeta here outside the unit disk, and the polynomial is real, just then the Chebyshev polynomials achieve the maximum value at the point zeta. And it's and he posed as a problem to find out which is the polynomial. So now I want to check out that these two problems really are equivalent, yeah? And they can transfer information that I know from one problem to the other. So that's a proposition. It's not a tip, but it's curious that they're actually equivalent, and they can make this a bit more precise and it's a bit more relevant. What they claim is that this is the first problem. The problem in optimal prediction is the first one is to minimize the reproducing kernel on the diagonal among all possible measures in K, and the value of this quantity coincides with the value of the reproducing kernel on the diagonal coincides with this quotient, which is given in terms of the all infinity norms. Observe here that here it's a problem, this is an L2 problem. The thing on this on the left is an L2 problem because the reproducing kernel on the diagonal, this is an L2 problem. And while the thing on the right is an L infinity problem. So two problems of different nature, but they both coincide here. Okay, minimum of this. And I will provide the proof because this part. So the proof is the following. I start with the quantity on the left. So this is the minimum among all probability measures of the reproducing kernel on the diagonal. In the reproducing kernel on the diagonal, I use the variational formulation, is the maximum of the polynomial of this quotient where among all polynomials which has value 1. And here is the L2 norm. Of course, this maximum here goes as a minimum. So I just put everything on the left. That's nothing. That's 1 over the max. I want to maximize this now over all possible measures, the minimum of the L2 norms of the polynomials which have value. So this is just a reformulation. I did nothing here. And now I want to examine this quantity in the denominator. So I look at this quantity in the denominator. What I have is the integral over k of the polynomial with respect to mu. And what things which are changing here, I'm taking the minimum over all the polynomials and the maximum over all measures. So I look at this functional probability measures. Okay? So I have probability measures and a polynomial with value 1. I take this all to this quantity. And I observe that f, of course, is a linear function in mu, and it's convex in the variable p, the polynomial. This quantity is convex in the polynomial. So it's linear in this variable, convex in p. Mu is a convex set here, because it's a probability measures. The polynomials here, it's also a convex set, which have value 1, it's a convex set here. So I have two, I minimize and maximize over a convex set, and I can apply von Neumann minimax theorem, exactly. So which is that this quantity, which is the thing that appeared in the denominator before, so that's what I appear here in the denominator, the maximum or the minimum here, coincides, I can reverse the minimax, I can reverse the order, the minimum of the maximum. Now, and when I'm in this situation, well, I have now fixed P of zeta, now P is fixed now, and I want to maximize the L2 norm with respect to the measures, the probability measures. Well, when this L2 norm is maximized, one P is fixed, well, I just have to take, me is supported in the measure of K, I just have to take a direct delta at the supremum, at the point where P is achieved, the maximum is achieved. So here, this quantity here is just the L infinity norm squared, right? So that's what I get. The maximum here is the L infinity norm squared. And that's exactly what we got. So that's the end of the proof. Okay? So we connected the two problems. The two problems, if I know the solution of one, I know the solution of the other. But not just of the values. It's possible to give a more precise formulation of this problem. It's a more complicated result, but it's possible to connect not just the values, but it's also possible to connect the polynomials that are extremal for the two problems. Okay? One of the problems is the one of the minimum variance and the other of the extremal. And that's the theorem that we have, which is an elaboration of the previous thing. It says that given a measure, a probability measure supported on K, well, this is an optimal prediction measure. So it's one of these measures that minimizes the reproducing kernel for a point, given point outside of K, if and only if the associated prediction polynomial, this is the polynomial that achieves the maximum in the reproducing kernel, satisfies that this thing is an equality. And equivalently, if and only if the associated prediction polynomial is also a polynomial of extremal growth that is iterative, it solves the second problem. If you want the Erdos problem. Now, observe also that. Well, this thing here says that if the maximum is this, it also says where the support of K is achieved. It cannot be in an arbitrary region of K, because if the maximum here is, it has equal to be a constant, so it's supported on sets where the modulus of P is equal to a constant. So it's in some level sets. The prediction measure, this equality says that the prediction measure must lie in some analytic sets. It also gives information about the geometry of the possible geometries of the prediction measures. Okay. Now, this is our theorem, that's just a connection of the two problems, and then we are able to draw some corollaries, if you want, of this, just by exploiting things that are known in one of the problem and transferring it to the other. For instance, we go back to the example, the classical example in one complex variable now. So we are, k is the interval minus 1, 1. And In this case, by the previous result, the support of an optimal prediction measure is a subset. Well, it will set minus 1, 1. It's a subset where this achieves the maximum value, right? But this set, where this has maximum value, it has at most two endpoints, right? Because this is a polynomial, if you want, this times the conjugate. So this thing has two endpoints at most, but it has a maximum value, so the derivative also is zero. So that means that really the support, the fact that we are here, it says that the optimal prediction measure will have n minus one interior points, which are going to be double points, so this means 2n minus 2 points, plus the two endpoints, minus 1 and 1. So really, it says that the measure is going to have exactly this form. So we know from the previous result that the optimal prediction measure will have this form, and this is going to be a probability measure, and the first point and the last point are the endpoints of the interval. Very good. So that's what we know. And this is for any zeta. It can be the zeta is real or not real. It doesn't matter. This is the form. And well, in in this case, there is we know a priori that this is the form of the prediction measure. It is not hard to check which is going to be the weights. And this was checked already by Levine. Suppose that this is given, and among all discrete probability measure supports at these points, this measure, which is given, this is the Lagrange interpolating polynomials that have value Li at the point xj is 1 or 0, depending if I or j are different. Well, this provides the weights here. If you know the points, the weights are given. So that's by this proposition, by Holland-Levin, it's not very hard. And the Lagrange polynomial minimizes this quantity. Right? So you want to find now the extremal polynomial. If you want to find the optimal prediction measure, you just need to find the points xa, these points in the interval. Because once you have the points, the measure, you know already by this proposition, and you know the values. And well, we using now the connection with the optimal prediction measure, we can, for at least for certain points, we can give an explicit expression. So now here we are in minus 1, 1, and this is not the Erdos setting. So now we are here in. And now in my point zeta is of this form. It's a point on the imaginary axis. And in this case, we can find some a family of a recurrence family of polynomials, which look similar to the, it's the same recurrence that the Chebyshev polynomial satisfy, but with different starting points. Q1 of zeta and Q2 of zeta, we compute the best polynomials that's right. And in general, Qn of zeta is going to be the optimal polynomial. So we identify the polynomials that give you the optimal prediction. And therefore, we solve the Erdos problem, if you want, in for points of the form A, because the two problems are connected. And one curiosity here is that for points which were real, points were here of the form x real, there was the polynomial which is maximal here among the polynomials that have absolute value smaller than 1 is always the same independent of the point zeta. It was always the Chebyshev polynomial. Here, the polynomials Qn of zeta, which are you see, they depend on the point A. So depending on A, you get different. And moreover, Boss in a recent preprint, that's not our original book, but just result, has found out which are the not just the polynomials that the prediction polynomials, but also the prediction measures, and he has proved that the prediction measures in this case, again in this case, zeta equal imaginary points, in the prediction measures weakly converge to the Poisson, to the push forward of the Poisson measure by the Joukowsky map. So this map is the map that maps the exterior of a disk, exterior of an interval, and you look at the Poisson, you look at the Poisson measure at the point I of A here, and you take the push forward of this measure, and this is some measure distributed this interval. So these measures, the measures of optimal sampling, accumulate here to the Poisson measure of this Joukowsky map. Okay? And moreover, this mu n are the Gauss-Lovato measures associated to of the grid. So we have a full characterization of the prediction polynomial and of the prediction measures for the case of a very simple case of the polynomial of the compact k, minus 1, 1, and points zeta in the imaginary axis. But the connection in between these two problems is what allowed us to do this, and this is true for an arbitrary compact set in C. And I think that's all I wanted to say. I finished 3 minutes earlier, but I think that's should be okay. So, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Joaquin. Let's thank the speaker first. If you have any question, please either say it or type it in the chat.
Oops, I'm sorry. Now I can see the chat. I'm sorry about the problem of the audio. That I was not aware of this during the talk.
And there's always some technical difficulty.
Yes, it's a nightmare. Oof.
If not, let's thank Joaquin again.
Thank you
very much. We have about 10 minutes